What's up, Bubba? Early in the morning, huh, bro?
A little too early.
Too early? Yeah. It's like 5 in the morning, huh?
Yeah.
And we are in Lexington. Right?
Yep.
April 17th. We're going to go watch the shot heard around the world. Right? You know what that is? It's when they started the American Revolution. Revolutionary War. You're gonna love it, buddy. It's gonna be awesome. Good. Go stand up, I'll take this. Look at that, you look like General George Patton.
You with the camera rolling? Hey, hello, where'd you find an old big flag? Two of America's best.
The Lexington Minutemen. Thank you all for coming to witness our portrayal of the first battle of the American Revolution. On the field today are the Lexington Minutemen, His Majesty's 10th Regiment of Foot, the 1st Foot Guards, the 4th, 5th, 33rd, and 52nd Regiments, the Marines, and the 16th Light Dragoons. Before I paint the backdrop, I would like to thank the hard work of the men and women of the Lexington Police, Fire, and Public Works Departments, and the Lexington Historical Society, Town Celebrations Committee, and the town officials for their tireless efforts throughout the night and throughout the many years supporting this event.
Hey guys, I'm short.
During the time since Thank you. During the time since our last reenactment held last year, the Lexington Minutemen has lost 4 of its members, Richard Hart, Guy Hughes, Henry Murphy, and Dan Sabota, past captain commanding. In addition to those 4, just weeks ago, the reenactment community lost a notable member of many local colonial-era fife and drum corps, drumming master Richard Ruquist. His true passion was marching and drumming in fife and drum corps, which he did for 70 years. In the 18th century, the steady rhythm and spirited tunes of the fifers and drummers would help keep the soldiers' minds off the long and tedious march. But more importantly, fifes and drums served as a signal for the infantry, relaying commander's orders, and in the heat of battle, the drums provide nonverbal commands to keep order among the chaos. While the fifes may bring the melodies, the drum is the heartbeat. Dick portrayed William Diamond in this very reenactment for many years. As a fifer, I've spent countless hours with Dick on the street, marching in parades, standing in ceremonies, and participating in fife and drum gatherings. He was an inspiration, instructor, and mentor to many, including a young neighbor of his who himself has taken on the role of William Diamond. Upon the news of Dick's death, a fellow fifer commented that he could always pick out Dick's drum beat, regardless of how many other drums were playing at the time. He was just that good. Although his beat will no longer be heard, he will remain in the hearts and minds of many of us when we hear colonial music, near or far. Please join me in a brief moment of silence for Dr. Dick Ruquist. Thank you. Along the theme of drumming, I would like to welcome to today's event a member of the Daughters of the American Revolution and direct descendant of William Diamond, Becky Gardefee from Spring, Texas, along with 14 members of her family, including her husband, children, and grandchildren. Thank you for making the long journey to be with us this weekend. We are honored to have you here.
Thank you.
finally set the stage. It is now 1775. There are no paved roads. There is no flagpole, no statue, no Zoom meetings, or daily Wordle. This is a small rural town west of Boston, originally settled as Cambridge Farms, and was incorporated as the town of Lexington in 1713. As many of you know, in the years leading up to 1775, British Parliament imposed various taxes on its colonies. Tensions between England and the colonies grew steadily. King George III found it necessary to keep military forces in Boston to contain the colonists' resentment and to support the royal governor. In 1773, the Lexington Militia, also known as the Lexington Training Band, was formed under the command of Captain John Parker. They reaffirmed their resolve to fight for freedom and liberty by taking this pledge. We trust in God, that should the state of our affairs require it, we shall be ready to sacrifice our estates and everything dear in life, yea, in life itself, in support of the common cause. By 1774, virtually every town within 50 miles of Boston had formed their own militia, or minute company, and took similar oaths. A few of the towns had also become storage depots for gunpowder and military supplies. The town of Concord, just west of here, was one of those places. On the night of April 18th, Paul Revere set out on horseback from Boston to alert local militia captains of the impending march of the British regulars. He also rode to Lexington to alert John Hancock and Samuel Adams, who were staying at the home of Reverend Jonas Clark, a short distance north of this common. There was worry that the regulars were coming to seize these two patriots. Along the route, Revere cried the alarm to villagers that the British regulars were on the march. Unlike popular belief, he did not shout out, "The British are coming," but rather, "The regulars are out." Paul Revere's speed on horseback could not be matched by the hundreds of British regular soldiers slowly plodding through the night as they steadily marched towards Lexington. Upon Revere's arrival in Lexington around midnight, Captain Parker ordered the sounding of the alarm bell in the belfry to notify the townspeople and militia of the imminent danger. Back then, the belfry stood here on the common, not far from the viewing platform. Townspeople appeared from their homes throughout the night and assembled here on this common. After much anticipation and delay, many of the militia members who had answered the alarm were allowed to retire. Those living close returned to their homes, some remained on the common, and several retired to Buckman Tavern, which you can see standing nearby. Throughout the night, Parker sent scouts on horseback on the road towards Boston to watch for the movement of the regulars. After Paul Revere had warned Hancock and Adams, Revere had spied a patrol of British officers on horseback, heading towards Lincoln. This patrol spotted Revere and captured him, but they released him shortly thereafter, and he walked back to Lexington, where Hancock and Adams were preparing to evacuate to Woburn and away from the column of British regulars heading this way. It wasn't until daybreak when Thaddeus Bowman returned on horseback to Buckman Tavern to warn Captain Parker that the regulars were indeed on their way and very close. As we begin the reenactment, this is the scene. Some militia members are on the common, and others are inside or around Buckman Tavern. Inside, Captain Parker anxiously awaits any news of the regulars and their whereabouts. You will see Thaddeus Bowman arrive on horseback and alert Captain Parker of the news.